As Damian already mentioned, I will be talking about isogeometric analysis, which is an approach to merge that aims to merge geometric modeling and numerical simulations. But okay, here is the overview of my talk. I will do my short intro, and then I will shortly introduce this new concept of isogeometric analysis and present some challenges which are related to that, and also some things that are in process. And in the second part, I will focus on three different developments or aspects that we have been working on with respect to isogeometric analysis, without going into much detail, but just sketching a bit the problems and the approaches for the solution. And this will be related to low-rank approximation, local adaptivity, and splines with on general topologies. And finally, yes, I will also tell you about the library that I have been developing. Okay, so then let's go to the first part. Yes, I'm Angelos Mantzaflaris. I joined AROMATH in 2019, but I've been at INRIA before, doing my PhD in the Galad team from 2008 until 2011. So after my PhD, I moved to Austria, where I've been working at the Austrian Academy of Sciences, at the RICAM, at the Radon Institute of Numerical Mathematics, on topics related to isogeometric analysis and the things I present today. So my research interests include isogeometric analysis and, in general, the interplay between geometric modeling and numerical simulation, applied geometry and use of high-order methods for numerical simulation and optimization, scientific computing, software development on the aforementioned topics, and I also have a second hat, which is on symbolic numeric computations and algebraic algorithms, which will not be in the talk today. Okay, so let me go to the first part, which is the short introduction to geometric analysis. To motivate that, I'd like to recall the what is known as the finite element analysis, which is a numerical simulation approach to solve partial differential equations. So in order to describe physical phenomena, we would like to compute the solution, for instance, of the temperature of a body or the displacement of a body or things like that, and this breaks down to the solution of some differential equations, which we can approach numerically. And in order to do that in the engineering practice, we usually triangulate or we mesh the geometry. So if we are doing simulations on a blade, on a design blade, like the one I will show later on, we triangulate this geometric part, this geometric object, and we have to triangulate it usually and produce a triangulation. So the standard approach in finite element analysis is to produce a triangulation of the geometry and perform our simulation on this discretized object. Already we can see that the discretized object is not the same as the object we had in the beginning. So there's a geometry approximation error which is introduced, and whatever analysis we do on the discretized object must be mapped back to the original object we have. So the finite element analysis calls for making this triangulation, or sometimes even breaking into quads, and then treating every small piece as an independent element. And on this element, we can produce a numerical approximation of the local value, say, of an unknown field that we would like to have. So the alternative to that, which I'm interested in, is called isogeometric analysis. And it includes finite elements analysis as a special case. So what does that mean? So in the finite element analysis, all our small objects or our elements had to be linear. They had to be triangles or quads with linear edges, say, or hexes in 3D. However, in the isogeometric analysis, we are allowed to have curved objects, which are essentially the objects that we started in, because in computer geometric modeling, the design is done with smooth curves or smooth surfaces, which are based on splines or NURBS, which is an engineering standard. So here you see an isogeometric patch, and the main difference with the picture before is that here we have a group of elements, and they are all mapped under the same global geometry mapped to the actual object. So we always have this reference domain, but we always map it with the global map to the actual object. So again, the physical domain is described in a global way. Well, this is not really completely global. We will not have one full map for a very complicated object, but still we will have big patches of parts of the object which are described by a single geometry map. And this geometry map is usually described using this NI, which are B-splines basis functions, so polynomial basis functions of higher degree. It's more than linear, usually quadratic or cubic, but lately more interest in higher order geometric modeling using degree 4 or 5 comes into play. And after doing this, after having this representation of the geometry, we will use the isogeometric analysis concept calls to use the same kind of functions to approximate the unknown solution to our partial differential equation. And there is a composition with our geometry map, which gives us functions, real functions, say, to approximate a scalar field. So this is just the general idea of this model. Of course, there is a big zoo, so to say, of different spline constructions that one can use for that. So it's a very general concept, but in practice, one can have splines based on tensor product construction, like the one I show here, or even better, splines that are tensor product construction, but also allow for local enrichment of the space. Local enrichment of the space is something that we need in numerical simulation, because usually interesting phenomena and interesting things happen at small regions of the domain. And in those small regions, we want to have finer basis functions in order to have higher order approximation. And there are even more exotic basis functions, like these box splines that I show here, that I've even defined on different kind of supports, like these hexagonal supports here. The main disadvantage of this, of the classical tensor product splines, is that the local refinement must be done across a full edge. So if I want to refine and get finer functions at one point, say here, I would have to propagate this along the whole line of the side. But I will come to this again. So what are the features and challenges of isogeometric analysis? So the general concept and the general aim is to change the way we do geometric modeling today and integrate that with numerical simulation. So usually, well, over the last, many decades, 60 years maybe, the domain of geometric modeling has been developed independently of the domain of numerical simulation. That means that even in big companies, there is a separate department that has as target to make the design, make the models, and a different department which deals with making some, assessing the quality of the models and making some analysis on these models in order to test if they are good or they should be changed. Therefore, this communication between this geometric modeling side and the numerical analysis side has been left, not very close. So this is the one of the things that isogeometric analysis would like to improve by providing a bidirectional communication between the two. So providing a closer link between the approaches for designing a model and the approaches to make analysis on a model. And one main breakup between these two is this step of computing an approximation of the geometry, of discretizing the geometry and changing actually the model in order to make it suitable for the analysis procedure, the finite element analysis procedure, to apply. One argument for isogeometric analysis is that it has superior approximation properties and exhibits higher accuracy per degree of freedom. And three challenges that I would like to focus on here is, first of all, the computational efficiency, because when working with higher order polynomials, we obtain methods that use more time to perform evaluation, differentiation, or more time to handle the model, so to say. And therefore, here we need efficient numerical algebra methods, and efficient methods, say, for numerical integration, which is the main, one of the main ingredients of performing simulation. So we have to compute integrals. These integrals do not have exact formulas, so they have to be approximated, and the approximation is typically done by numerical integration and by quadrature. Another challenge is namely local refinement, which I already sketched before. The typical the engineering standard tensor product splines do not allow for local adaptivity. Therefore, more flexible splines are needed. And I would like to, well, there are a few approaches like the T-splines, lately the U-splines, or even LR splines and so on. But I would like to mention our approach, which is mainly based on hierarchical splines. And I will motivate why this is a good one. And last but not least is to change the geometric modeling procedures in order to have analysis suitable designs. Again, meaning that the design or the way the model is represented on the system is suitable in order to be assessed and in order to make analysis on that. Therefore, we have to develop geometric models that support analysis processes. And this is the main thing. So I get this picture back from this book that has appeared in 2009, where you get this painting of Michelangelo, where Adam has been renamed to analysis and God into geometry. And there you see, well, graphically, the holy grail of isogeometric analysis, which is to make these two different worlds come together and talk to each other, or touch each other. Okay, so this said, let me go to the third part, which is to sketch a few methods and a few approaches that we have been using to advance on the above topics. Let me motivate this part by a comparison between isogeometric analysis and standard finite element analysis. Here you see an analysis which is performed on a blade. It's in an air turbine blade, and you see the deformation that is happening to the blade when the air turbine is turning. So I got it from this paper back in 2012, and so here in the graph on the left, you have the displacement on this top corner, which is red, and we have a comparison between isogeometric analysis run with quadratic C1 elements and classical finite elements, quadratic again. And you see that the isogeometric analysis has used much less degrees of freedom. So the problem, in order to get the same displacement, the size of the problem that the computer had to solve has been much, much smaller than the corresponding size that was needed to get the same accuracy with the classical approach. So this is like a really good result, a really good thing to see. However, one should also check the how much time it was spent for finding the best this same result, because at the end of the day we're interested in computational times and not just numbers of degrees of freedom. So with respect to that, you have two graphs here. The first one is the time that was used for the linear solver to solve the system, to solve the problem. And this was more or less comparable in this case. However, the time that was needed to set up the system matrix, the linear system to solve, and has been much worse with isogeometric analysis than with the typical approach. And this can be explained easily because the basis functions, so the elements that are used in isogeometric analysis and the basis functions over these elements, they span much more elements than in the classical FEM. So this means that much more quadrature points have been used. The matrices that are constructed have much bigger bandwidth, and all this burdens the whole process of analysis. So, well, to give a kind of an answer to this problem, I would like to show you this approach of low rank approximation. So when we're using tensor product splines, our spline space is actually a tensor product. So in that case, it makes sense to search for a lower rank approximation of this tensor product space. What it means, so assume you have a matrix A. Even though the matrix can be stored on the computer using n square n elements, the actual, the minimum, say, amount of memory that one could use to store this matrix depends on the rank of this matrix. Therefore, if this matrix has rank R, using a singular value decomposition, which is a decomposition into two orthonormal side matrices plus a central diagonal matrix, which I'll call the singular values, you can use much less memory, which is actually proportional to R, the rank, in order to have this matrix. And moreover, all the operations on this matrix can be done much more efficiently using this kind of representation. So I show it to you on two dimensions, but there is an analog in 3D and 4D. It is a little more complicated to arrive to such decompositions, but you can get much more or less the same advantage. So with a complexity analysis of the procedure of making the system matrix, one can see that the complexity is n to the d, where n is the number of basis functions in one dimension, like the size of this matrix. D is the degree, no, d is the dimension, 2 or 3. P is the polynomial degree. And so you have a P to the 3D. So the polynomial degree, really, we can see here that plays a big role in the final complexity because the exponent is quite small. However, if you make a low rank approach, which means if you first decompose all your functions and all your geometrical representations into such a format, you can reduce this to essentially R times N P to the 3. So to show this graphically, when you want to compute this kind of integrals in multi dimensions, you want to approximate this kind of a matrix by a sum of smaller matrices which are compiled by Kronecker product here. So instead of storing a big matrix like this, which is of size n square, you can store r times small matrices of smaller matrix which are of size n times n. So roughly to say, we can decompose a big problem into smaller problems. It's not as easy as this, but this is the same idea, the main idea. Okay, so a second problem is the mesh adaptivity. So we would like to have a local enrichment of the space at points where we need a higher approximation. And for instance, here in this typical L-shape example, which is a typical benchmark in finite elements, you have here at the corner a singular point. So at that point, the solution is singular, the derivatives do not exist, so the solvers have problem finding high accuracy in that small part. And in fact, this has been a challenge problem that was proposed in a big numerical analysis list, say, in 2018. And there have been many replies to that problem, which are reported in this archive paper. And very few were able to actually find high-order approximations, many correct digits, close to this point because of the singularity. This is a typical situation where the finite elements do not succeed. Well, we tried this approach with the hierarchical splines, which are splines that are highly smooth everywhere and allow for this local adaptivity. And we were able with only a fraction of the degrees of freedom, around 30,000 degrees of freedom, to really catch a high approximation of the solution at this point, which was requested, 0.9, 0.9. Whereas a typical finite element software needed much, much more in order to get even less digits. So we use degree 5 here and level 10 levels of refinement. So these are just the details, but it's just to say that adaptivity is possible and higher order accuracy solutions are feasible. And in this construction, these hierarchical splines, a background tensor product structure exists. So apart from having locality, we can also make things quite efficient in practice. So when we actually perform the numerical integration. Okay, and here is one more development. It's good to show these, so to say, simple examples or the L-shaped benchmarks, but in the real engineering practice and the real world, the shapes are much more complex and they have much more requirements. So in order to model complex shapes like this dolphin, which is, say, more complex like than an L shape, we would patch together, we would stitch together many smaller patches. If we have quadratic, well, tensor product patches with four sides, we would stitch many of them together. And in that case, what would appear will be also vertices of the mesh, like here, where we have valence different than 4. So this we call them extraordinary vertices, or here where we have valence 5, say. And what will also appear is also this T junction. So two patches coming together and a third one making a T. So in order to handle these topological features, one needs, in order to have smooth splines, so continuous splines with high smoothness all over the model, not just inside the patch, but at the joining of the patches, we have to develop more complex splines. And these more complex splines, they have been developed for some time in the geometric model community, but now they have revived due to their use in analysis. So these are the G1 splines, so splines that guarantee that when we pass from one patch to the next one, the tangent plane is continuous. So we have like a smooth transition from each patch to the next, even at these T junctions or even at these extraordinary points. And here you can see how this is usually checked. And this is usually checked by these reflection lines. So here you have a transition between like six patches. So six patches come together at an extraordinary vertex. And what you see, these lines, they're called reflection lines, and they're actually the reflection of a hypothetical light that would point on the surface. Actually, this process has been used back in the early times of the automobile industry, where they really put lights over the cars in order to see if the final result, if the final car is looking good. But now this is a bit more than looking good. What we want to have high continuity, and we want to have a smooth transition and derivatives which are existing everywhere. So here you see on the right one construction which finally gives us a good transition. So the reflection lines are continuous and smooth. And here is a case where the reflection lines are not continuous. So we can see that this surface will have a problem here. It means that when we make numerical simulation on that, we would expect that things might go wrong at this part. So there is a whole zoo of this kind of constructions. And this is one project that we are working on, trying to develop smooth G1 splines on arbitrary domains like this. So here we have some tests. We have been testing the Gauss curvature and testing if the result is appropriate. Okay. So let me just finish with the software development, because all these approaches have to be tested and shared with other people and have to be working in practice for everybody. So in this goal, we have been working on an open source library for isogeometric analysis, which is called Gizmo, Geometry Plus Simulation Modules, which you can find on GitHub. And it's written on C++, it's object-oriented and templated, and it aims at advancing the geometric paradigm to a more mature simulation technology. We make annual workshops devoted to code development, and we will have one at INRIA this December, co-located with a software and industrial event of this GRAPES project, which is a H2020 project which is running on the AROMATH team. You will have the chance to hear more about our software Gizmo, and as well as Seagull and PyTorch Geometric, which is a library over PyTorch that does machine learning for geometric objects. So with this, let me finish, and thank you for your attention.